So, good morning or afternoon, whatever it is, where you are. My name is Phil Gibbins and this is Marian Dawson. We both work for Cambridge English, looking after the exams that we'll be focusing on today. We will look at how preparing for B2 First or First for Schools and C1 Advanced can help learners develop the skills that they will need when they finish school, for university and for the world of work. It will also show how learners can use their certificates to open up opportunities when applying to university at home or abroad and help them to stand out in the jobs market. Okay. So this webinar aims to help you with the following areas. Okay. Understand the skills learners need to succeed at university and in the workplace. It will help you to identify ways to help learners develop the language skills they need for the first or first for schools and advanced exams, and for life after school. And you will have some classroom activities to use with your learners. Okay. There are a couple of questions here. I'd like you to use the chat box for responses to these two. So I'll read them out. Why do your students choose to take the first for schools and advanced exams? And do you expect many of your learners to use English in their careers? As I said, if you've got any answers to those questions, feel free to share them.
So we've got a lot of people joining here from Italy, mm-hmm. Russia, Mexico, Pakistan, Iran, Greece.
Okay, so we have to apply for a scholarship to enter university because they wish to study in England, yeah, or other English-speaking countries.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So a lot of answers coming in.
About to study abroad and the labour market. Okay. So, yeah, as you can see, getting into a good university and gaining a high enough level of English to study in an English-speaking country is one key area. And also, you know, to get ahead of other applicants, to find the best jobs, develop the skills and language to excel at work. So regardless of whether learners are going into work or university, many will benefit from developing English skills. It's a language of international academic research and of business communication, as you know. If students have a clear idea of what they want to do now, great, this may help them identify and then develop the knowledge and skills that they may need in later life. It's more motivating to learn something when the personal benefits of doing so are clear. But if learners still don't know, that's okay too, because English skills are transferable, and we'll be looking at this. Okay, so thinking about real-world English skills, context is an essential component of language teaching because it establishes understanding. So it helps to establish a context for real-world English skills, and we're going to look at a case study of someone called Anya. Now, as you hear about Anya's situation, consider the English skills Anya may need to use in the different situations, and whether these skills may be relevant for your learners now or in the future. So here's Anya. We're going to follow her around for a day and look at the English skills she needs at various points. Okay, so note the English skills covered. Okay, so Anya is from Riga in Latvia, and her first language is Latvian, but she also speaks Russian and passed a B2 level English exam following her foundation year. She's in her final year of a marketing degree at a university in the UK, and is applying for places on a graduate scheme within UK-based international organisations. Her course is very international, with 45% of the students being from overseas. And the course involves lots of collaboration with other students, some of whom are based elsewhere. So English is the common language they use. Okay. So we're going to look at, first of all, the seminar that Anya's involved in, and I want you to think about which language skills Anya is going to use and when. Okay. So let's look at a typical situation at university for Anya. So she's in a marketing strategy seminar. It's 10 a.m. and the tutor is giving an overview of a marketing plan. Anya works with her partner in a group and their task is to identify problems with the plan, then to brainstorm solutions before agreeing on 5 key proposals, which are to be shared with the rest of the group at the end of the session. Her partner didn't do the recommended reading before the session, so Anya has to explain some of the terms. Her partner has lots of ideas, but Anya doesn't agree with all of them. Talk through the header and ask the question. Okay. So, which skills is Anya going to need to use and when? Okay. All right, so she's going to need all really of the following skills which we'll look at. Okay. So we have turn taking. She's discussing with her partner and groups, so she's going to need to learn when to speak and when not to. Active listening, okay? Listening for gist at times and detail others. And negotiating meaning. Checking understanding and paraphrasing. Politely disagreeing. Making suggestions and note-taking. So all of these skills are going to be needed in the strategy seminar.
And Phil, a lot of people were mentioning those strategies in the chat box.
Okay.
So good. That was really good.
Okay, good. All right. So it's later in the day for Anya. And now she's got to write up her assignment. Okay. So again, which language skills is she going to use and when? So it's 2:30. Oh, sorry, gone too far there. It's 2:30. And after the lecture, Anya has an assignment. She needs to analyse the marketing plan her tutor provided. It's important that she checks her ideas with academic sources. She decides to watch a recording of the morning lecture and add to the notes she took. And she downloads some of the recommended texts, including podcasts, her lecturer talked about in the lecture. There's a lot to do before she can start writing her assignment. Okay, so let's look at the language skills that she needs for her research, as you can see on the left here. Okay, so there's reading and listening for gist. Okay, then there's scanning for specific information, reading for detail, and taking notes. Okay, whether that's note taking from the reading that she's doing, or the listening to podcasts, or the seminar that she saw this morning. Okay. All right, and she's got the assignment, so she's going to have to write it up. And there's a lot of skills needed here. So it's generating and organising ideas, thinking through the appropriate structure and style that is needed for that writing. Hopefully she'll be drafting her first piece of work and then editing it. And if it's academic writing, then obviously when you come to hand it in, you need to make sure you've referenced it appropriately. So all of these skills need to be thought through. Okay. So let's think back Anya's first day at university and think about your learners, whether they're studying for first or advanced, and the things that they will need to know. Okay. So the skills that you teach your students and that they need for our exams, would they be useful for her after university? Okay. Are the skills and study strategies Anya uses only useful if students are learning English? Okay. It's impossible to know the professional situations that learners will encounter, as it's likely that many of the jobs they will spend the majority of their working lives doing do not yet exist. So the case study focuses on corporate undergraduate degrees, and the situations may be of less relevance to others. However, although these situations may not all be relevant for learners, the skills necessary to be successful with them are transferable. So many of these language skills and study strategies are also relevant in other languages. Things such as note-taking, mind mapping, and active listening, these are helpful skills regardless of the language which is being used. Okay. Any further comments there?
We've got a lot of people, a lot of you coming into us with comments, talking about transferable skills, being able to use these skills after university in a workplace situation, and also being able to use them for other subjects. Too many people to mention, just so many of you. But yes, seems like we're all on the same page.
Okay, all right, so I'll hand over to you now. I'll take that off
you. Mr. Phil. So, let's have a look. Language skills for the workplace. For many, the aim of higher education is preparation for the workplace through the attainment of knowledge or skills and qualifications. And many of the skills required within an academic setting are also used in the workplace, which is what we will look at next. So what I'd like to ask you to do is to look at the images and think about what they might represent in an academic setting. I'll just give you a moment to think about that. Now I'm going to reveal the labels. So the first one, we can see lectures, seminars and discussions, collaborative assignments, working together, written assignments, and research. And we can see that these are activities that we have just been looking at in the case study with Anya. So how would the language skills and strategies that are required for these activities be useful in the workplace? Send us your ideas using the chat box. So, Phil, have we got any ideas coming through?
I think they've still got the old ones from before coming through.
That's okay.
It says presentation, brainstorming, cooperation, note-taking.
Yeah, so these are all things that you do in the academic context, but also use
written
them very much.
Written assignments, teamwork, video conferences.
Wow, so lots of ideas.
Yeah.
Fantastic. So what we're going to look at now is academic and workplace skills. And here we have the four areas for skills. Starting on the left, we've got a picture for reading, then speaking, listening with the headphones, and finally on the right, writing. When and where do we use these skills? I'll give you a clue. Anya used these skills at university. And for writing, for example, we had seminars, writing essays, note-taking in seminars, collaboration. If we look at the reading, checking emails, researching, these were all things that Anya did at university, which are good academic skills. Let's have a look at the workplace. And equivalent skills could be used in the workplace as well. For example, checking emails, with the reading, participating in meetings, with the speaking, attending presentations for listening, and writing reports for the writing skills. So we can see the similarity in the types of skills that might be used in both study and work. How do B2 First and B2 First for Schools and the C1 Advanced exams support the development of these skills? Let's take a look.
Okay, so now that we're familiar with the skills that are necessary for university and the workplace, we're going to move on to looking at some exam tasks found in the first and advanced exams and understand how the tasks are designed to support the development of these skills. We'll also look at some teaching ideas that you can use in the classroom with your students to ensure they are ready for the exam. Okay, now this is a task taken from the B2 First for Schools speaking exam. Part two, the long term. And learners must talk about the two pictures, okay? What's the real world value of this task? Okay, again, write your comments in the chat box if you would like. Okay, so what do you think the real world value of part two speaking is?
So people are talking about conferences, about using such tasks and skills for critical thinking, for group work, for calls, for researching on the internet, searching for information, evaluating options. The ideas are coming in too fast now for me to read. Mm-hmm. Lots of good ideas.
Okay, so obviously they're real world skills here, talking about a relevant topical subject. And an important part in this part of the test, and it's the same in advance, is talking for an extended period of time. So you're not, it's not just pinging questions and answers. This part of the test is you have to develop your own speaking through, it's usually about a minute that you have to talk for. Okay, so how can we develop these skills in the classroom? Okay, so if you want to practice the format of the exam, you can use any two pictures that you think your students might be interested in, or you can even ask your students to bring in their own pictures to you. So that's not too hard to do. You also need to focus on the language and skills that are required to do that task. And it's always useful to elicit useful language and phrases from your learners so that you can see what your students already know and then fill in any gaps in their knowledge. So some useful language when you're talking about pictures, and this is not just comparing pictures, this is comparing ideas as well, you know, when they're talking in lots of different situations. So you've got both X and Y. X is this, whereas Y is that, okay? One thing X and Y have in common is, etc. X and Y are quite similar or quite different because, etc. And then unlike X, Y is. So teaching your students these quite simple, really, expressions for comparing and contrasting, they're good for the pictures here in the exam. But it's useful language for a whole range of situations, when it's, say, discussing different ideas, talking about politics or whatever. You know, to learning to compare things and to talk politely and skillfully about the different ideas that you might have. Okay. So, now we're going to look at the third part of the speaking in First for Schools, which is the collaborative task. And in this part, the learners talk together about a topic, for a couple of minutes. So an idea to get them to practice this, so it's getting them to talk together on one topic for a couple of minutes, okay? They talk about a particular statement or things that they can do. So you could get some sample statements for them to debate, okay? Just, we'll show you some ideas in a minute. Okay, you can stick those statements on the wall around the room. Okay, if you're in the kind of place where you can do that, that's great. Okay, and then those become the speaking stations. Okay, so you can get the students to walk around the room and move from station to station, to quote David Bowie, in the classroom. Okay, you can group your students in twos or even threes if that helps. Okay. And then assign the students to a different speaking station. So put them in place and then they get the chance to move around. And then you have a timer, okay? So they have a 2-minute debate at each station. Now, what you might find is that you may need to assign students an agree or a disagree stance, because otherwise they may all agree with each other and it doesn't take much discussion then. This is also quite a useful skill in the actual exam. I always used to tell my students that it uses up the time more effectively to disagree with each other. Not in wild arguments, but just, you know, picking out things that are different. If you agree too readily, you can do things rather quickly. Okay, so think about whether you want to give people agree and disagree cards when they're at these speaking stations. Okay, so they have a timer and they have a 2-minute debate on the topic, but then give them a couple of minutes after they've spoken about that to take some notes about the things that sort of went well when they were talking, but they may also say, you know, I didn't know how to say this, I didn't understand when my partner said that. So they can make a few notes about what went well and what didn't go well about that discussion, okay? And then when they've done that, then they change the station and they, obviously then they move on to a new topic and you repeat again with the timer and again with the note taking as well for the speaking. And you know, you can go around for as many as are required to use up the class's store of great speaking activities. Okay, when they finish, bring the groups together, and then they can compare their ideas and notes. And you know, you may find that the whole class then had a problem with certain topics or how to respond to certain situations. And that gives you useful things to talk about in class. Okay, and then you can have the whole group feedback and then error correction, because while they were talking, you can be moving around and listening in on some parts of it and making notes, but they hopefully will also bring to you that they didn't know the word for this, they didn't know how to say these particular areas. Okay, so we talked about what could be some talking discussion points to put up in the classroom. Here are a few. The only way to learn a foreign language is to live abroad. Okay. Teenagers rely on their parents too much. They should be more independent. Imposing a sugar tax on sweets, chocolates, and fizzy drinks would encourage people to make healthier food choices. And learning to grow food and cook in school should be as important as learning English and maths. As you say, when you look at those, you may see that it may be a good idea to give people agree and disagree. So it forced them to think through what they could say, even if it's something that they personally are against. And teaching them that skill in a way to talk about something, even if it's not what they agree in, could be useful in the exam as well, and in a number of situations, in fact. Okay, so what language skills have been practiced there? Okay. Obviously, we can discuss agreeing and disagreeing, very important. Listening and responding appropriately. It's another thing when you're going round, is to make sure that, you know, in their pairs, they're not, one person isn't dominating, or one person isn't just sitting or standing very quietly. When they're in the exam, this is an important part of the interactive communication part, that you listen and respond appropriately. How to form an argument, giving reasons, making comparisons, negotiating. If they disagree, you know, is there some area that they do agree on, even if they disagree in some parts of it? Trying to reach an agreement, okay? And then again, the note-taking at the end is also a useful, you know, real-world skill on a discussion. Okay.
Okay.
Move you across. Any comments?
Lots of comments coming in through the chat box. People talking about negotiating, really liking the idea of the speaking stations. And we did have some appreciation of the mention of David Bowie as
okay,
well.
That's good.
Thank you for that.
Thank you.
There we go. So now we're going to have a look at listening skills. So listening skills can be developed through the use of exam tasks. These are selected for specific levels and can provide practice of listening to text types encountered in the real world. I'll just show you one example now. So using exam tasks like the one you can see on screen now can help to provide familiarity, reduce test anxiety, and help learners to demonstrate their ability. In this case, the example that we're looking at is from C1 Advanced Listening Part 2. Part 2 features a monologue, which is approximately 3 minutes in length, and texts typically take the form of talks, lectures, or broadcasts, and they are aimed at a non-specialist audience and are delivered in a neutral or semi-formal style. Learners may need to listen to similar monologues in the real world, so it's excellent practice for them, not just for the exam, but for real world situations that they might encounter in the future. Lectures, presentations, speeches, spoken reports, these are all types of things that Anya had in her day at university, and they're the type of thing that many students, many learners will experience for themselves in the future. So Cambridge exam texts are always representative of real-world text types. They help to develop listening sub-skills such as listening for global understanding, specific information, attitude, and deducing meaning from context. Let's think about how we can help prepare learners for listening in the real world by focusing on developing listening strategies in class and practicing listening skills such as listening for the main idea and listening for detail. Here are some ways the teacher can do this. So you can personalise the context, pre-teach useful language, introduce a speaker or writer, make predictions, review listening strategies, do a gist task, or set up a task purely to check understanding. So in the case of the C1 Advanced Part 2 listening task, before listening to Josh talking about his study trip, in the classroom you can use the image provided to invite speculation from your learners about Josh and what he might speak about, just from looking at the picture. In class, you can encourage your learners to engage in some speculation about Josh and what they're going to hear before you play the audio. So gist questions can help, such as who's speaking? Learners can be taught to listen for functional phrases of introduction, such as I'm a or I've been a. What about? It may be mentioned near the start of the audio that Josh says something like, I'm going to talk about, or there may be topic-specific vocabulary within the talk that would help. To whom? This is often covered at the beginning of a monologue as the listeners are addressed, so learners should listen for pronouns and names, as well as whether the information in the talk has been simplified for the listener, or if the speaker talks to them as experts. Why? Learners should listen for functional phrases that may suggest the speaker is trying to persuade or warn listeners. For example, you should and you've got to, or you mustn't or don't. So learners can be encouraged to speculate what else Josh might include in his talk. This is one way to develop learner listening skills before the audio starts. Now, what do learners have to do in this task? They need to listen and complete the sentences using a single word or phrase. To prepare in advance of the audio, learners should look at the questions and think about strategies. Their preparation could include highlighting key words, identifying synonyms, or predicting answers, for example. And we can see the highlighting now in the text doing just that. So the learners look at the task in this way, and the teacher elicits possible answers to the questions before the learners listen to the audio. Learners listen to the audio twice in the exam, which gives them the opportunity to listen and then listen and refine their answers. However, today in the webinar, we're not going to listen to the audio because it's far too long. But this example is taken from one of the C1 Advanced sample tests, and that's readily available on the website. So you can find the audio there as well. But for now, we're going to move on to talk about feedback. So it's quite useful to consider how you might check answers in the classroom with your learners and how you would manage that feedback from them. Do share any answers that you or ideas that you have in the chat box with us on how you might check answers from your learners and how you might deal with their feedback in the classroom.
Okay, well, got ideas coming in. I just want to say hi to Annunciata, who was very excited by the fact it was about South Africa, because she was born in South Africa.
Oh, so that's fine.
People highlighting really the importance of discussing the context and the people involved and what they might want to talk about before you listen. Obviously, the discussion of that's not something you can do in the exam, but it is something that gets them, that trains their mind to think about those things before they listen. And the people are liking the idea of the highlighting that's come up here. So it's trying to pick out those key words, key prompt words that you're going to listen to. So A lot of people by coming up with those ideas. People also mentioning taking notes when they're listening, so that they've got something to refer back to, because you hear it twice, obviously, in the tests. But if you haven't got some notes to look through, you're just kind of waiting for the second one. So you can be working kind of in between the listenings if you've taken some notes as well. Okay, lots and lots of ideas coming through there. Okay, do you want to go on?
Well, carry on. Thank you very much for all of those ideas and that feedback. That's really good to hear how you're thinking about doing the feedback, and also how you're understanding this idea and what your thoughts are on it. So thank you for that. Now, let's have a look at one possible process for giving feedback on listening tasks. This is just one idea, but it's a process that can be used for classroom feedback on listening activities. And I'm just going to talk you through it in a moment. I just stress it's not a teacher-centred process. It is intended that you would do it in the classroom, but it encourages learners to notice the answers and the reasons for them and to learn from each other. And then learners are led through this process by the teacher. The teacher is essential to justify their answers, with a focus on the how and the why in the answers to questions that they've come up with. It's also a process that can inform future learning and teaching, and ends with the planning of further action. So let's have a look at the process itself. So first of all, learners compare their answers, and then teachers can provide learners with a transcript. So that's a transcript of the audio that they've heard so that they can look at it together. They can then go through the transcript and highlight keywords or what they think are the keywords. Following that, they can then read the transcript from beginning to end, and they can correct their own listening answers. So they've done the listening and they've done the questions and they've been given the transcript after the audio, and they're now marking their own answers because they're able to check if they were correct or not because they're going through the transcript. Following that, the teacher then elicits the correct answers from the whole group, from the class, and finds out why those are the correct answers, so the justifications. Then learners can identify why they got something wrong, where their errors were, what made them think X was the answer when actually the answer was Y. And then learners can update their listening self-evaluation records, and the teacher can note any common issues to address, so remedial action can be planned. So as you'll see here, the ending of this process isn't really an ending, but really a link going forward to any future study. And we're talking here about a listening self-evaluation record. Well, what do you think that is? And what do you think could be included in a listening self-evaluation record? Do share your ideas on the chat box if you want to. And in a moment, I'll show you an example.
Okay. There's a lot of people talking about the usefulness of having the transcript and giving the students the transcript to work through. Yeah. People want to know more about the self-evaluation records. Uh-huh. There are questions. It's coming up in a minute.
Yeah.
They talked about the also using the transcript as a way of looking at new vocabulary as well. They can highlight the words that they don't understand. Yeah. And
good idea.
Okay, but some people saying the self-evaluation is something that can lead to development and more awareness of where their strengths and weaknesses are.
Yeah, okay. Absolutely. So we're going to end the suspense and move on to our example of the listening self-evaluation record. So here we go. A listening evaluation record can help learners to identify for themselves what they need to work on to improve their listening skills. So I'm just going to share with you some examples of the type of errors that learners might make in a listening activity. So issues with spelling, not knowing the word, mishearing something, not hearing it at all, getting lost in the recording and the questions, and misunderstanding the question. These are just examples, but if you can get learners recognising their own errors, then they'll work with you in the classroom to study further on the points that they now understand that they have issues with and they need further development in. So everyone can work together on this. And the sheet that we're sharing here could be shared as a photocopy or as an electronic record, or it could be copied down in exercise books. There are lots of different ways to do it. The key thing is that you as teachers need to ensure that the evaluation record is revisited and updated by learners after listening tasks, and remind learners that they need to be honest about how they've done in the task. So by focusing on learner improvement and recognition of errors, you can help to encourage that positive, non-judgmental learning environment. And then it's more likely that learners will be honest about what they've got wrong. Then the results noted in the listening evaluation record can really help to identify the focus for future study. And that's future study by both the learners and the teachers with the class in the classroom. So now we're going to look at listening to a talk. And we were just talking about that listening from Josh about his study trip in South Africa. So listening to a talk like the talk by Josh can be a useful tool to help work on listening skills. So this was a C1 activity, but using a different level listening task, you could use those same strategies with different levels of learners. And with the task, you could vary the level of challenge of the task. You can differentiate by requiring some learners to write fuller, longer answers, and some learners to choose the correct answer from a selection of possible answers, like multiple choice. Some learners will need more teacher support than others to complete this type of task, especially if they're not used to a more learner-oriented classroom. And if you want to extend the task, then some learners may be ready for additional listening tasks to further develop their listening skills. This might be giving them some additional questions to answer about the same audio, for example. Now, there are numerous ways in which learners can increase their skills, knowledge, and language when listening to the talk. So, for example, the learners can be listening for gist, for specific information, to predict answers, to become more familiar with genre, for example, in this case, short talks, to develop their vocabulary on a certain topic, or to increase familiarity with exam task types. Now, how does this activity support skills development? Now, the teacher's role here is to think about various points, the strategies to use in the classroom with the learners, the feedback method that they employ. Using a learner-centered process can be very successful, and relating this work to future study with the same class, so that there is a link from one piece of work and the next. And how do we relate these skills that we learn for exams and in study to those that learners will use in the real world? Well, situations in real life where learners will have to engage in extended listening, for example, at university or at work, could be such as these: lectures, presentations, meetings, seminars. And could this process that we've just outlined here with the listening task, looking at the task, highlighting different words, thinking about the language, predicting the answers, using a listening skills record, looking at the transcript that we have, could the same process be used to benefit learners' other language skills? Well, we would say yes. For example, it could be used for reading tasks. Okay, over to Phil.
Okay, just a few things coming up here. One person, was, I think it was Giovanna, was saying that you know, and analysing the listening in this way for students is, you know, it's very time consuming, and a lot of the teenagers just want to know their score, and they're not really interested in looking how what they got right and what they got wrong. And this is very true. I mean, we're talking about an ideal scenario in some ways, but, you know, we do have to think, how can we help students to improve their listening? If they're really not that engaged with improving their listening, it's true that it's going to be difficult to actually get them to do these things. But, you know, we're thinking about the people who do want to learn and do want to improve. Yeah. And so we have to aim some of the things at them as well. And we do our best, I suppose.
I think as well, the first time that you try something like this, it's maybe won't be a roaring success. It might take a little bit more time to explain and to get people to engage with it. But if you can show people that the results that you find at the end of where people are making errors, making mistakes, that the next class on listening, for example, included some work on those areas, then people start to see how you join the dots together. And teenagers maybe want just the score, but also they don't like working on things that they already understand. So if you're then moving on to work on the things that they need more help with, then hopefully you'll get a bit of a buy-in there. But it's never never very super easy, shall we say.
One other question that came up was in when you're looking at the error report, it said, what about the accent? And yeah, that's, it's a valid point, because sometimes it may be the accent of the speaker. But there was one box that said misheard the word. So I guess you could put it in there, but you might want to make a note. But that would be possibly that you misheard quite a lot of that text. We do recommend that, you know, you try to make sure your students get a range of accents. We don't use we don't check, you know, in the exams, we don't have, you know, people from Liverpool and Newcastle. There tend to be sort of Northern and Scottish and Irish and that. But they're usually quite gentle accents. They're not the strongest ones available. But it is useful to let your students have some familiarity with those.
I think just 2 points from me there. It's the listening evaluation record. If accent is a key thing for your learners, change the fields in the listening evaluation record, tailor it to your class so that it's useful to them. And also with listening, there's so much on the internet now, you know, podcasts, you can look at, I'm not sure if I'm allowed to mention, but videos, different video channels online as well, BBC World Service. There are so many things that you can look and that you can stream. And if you get a variety of different things, short talks, or it could be whole programs, it's you can get a real range of accents there. There's so much available.
Okay, and another topic that's been coming up in the chat box is the importance of writing. People saying, even for speaking, how important it is to for students to practice their writing. I've always said this as well. So let's have a look at writing now. Okay, that's our next area. And here's an example of a B2 First for Schools writing task. Now, there's always a choice of task types in Part 2, so students should avoid a particular task type if it's unsuited to their interests or experience. And each word in the instructions is important to the task. Students should therefore be advised to avoid a question if they're unsure of what is required, as their answer may not be wholly relevant. But they do need to read that question carefully, because it can be too easy to think, oh, this is about, you know, they see the word guitar, if you look in the example here, oh yeah, I love music, and things like that. If they haven't read the question carefully, they may not realise the type of language and what is expected of them. So make sure they get the read each question carefully, okay? And they should consider these questions before beginning to plan their writing, okay? So think through, who has written to you? Okay, in this case, it's Alex, their English-speaking friend, who writes a hell of a lot, because he writes to everybody in the exams. What kind of text must you write? Now, this is very important. You know, if you look at the bottom of the question, it says, write your email. So they need to make sure they remember what kind of writing this is, and whether they're familiar with that style of writing. Okay, what news does Alex tell you, and how do you feel about that? Okay, so really need to think through these things and make notes about them probably before they get started on anything. So it's checking the task. this is also a real world skill. You know, we've all must have sent emails back to somebody without fully reading it and then realized later that actually that question was already answered, or you've actually answered a completely different question, or you've completely upset somebody by not really reading what it was that was sent to you. Yeah. Okay. We're going to have a look at a model answer now. And here are a few questions about the model answers. But so before you have a look at it, so how many paragraphs are used? How does the email begin and end? How do we know the subject of the three main paragraphs straight away? Okay. So just have a look through. Okay. I realise we did rather answer question one with question three when we said how many paragraphs, and the third one said of the three paragraphs. But anyway, so you've got a nice model answer there. Three paragraphs would seem to be enough. And you know, you were given some, when you looked at the email, there were various points that were needed. Usually people write emails begin with hi, and then the name, and finish with some kind of salutation. Can be good luck, can be regards, depends how friendly it is. But emails are an area where, you know, it's not like the old writing a letter where we really expected dear so-and-so and then yours sincerely, yours faithfully. It is a more open, and as the examiners who are marking this are quite open to different approaches in there. We're looking at what's suitable for the person you're writing to rather than very specific opening and closing salutations and things like we used to have really in the past. So we've got three paragraphs, and if you look at each paragraph, the opening sentence tells you what that paragraph's about, and it relates back to the email that person received and the reason for answering the question in there. So we think it's a good idea to show learners a model answer so that they can see what they are aiming for. It can be a danger that they just copy half that out, but you make sure that they don't do that. Okay, so they need to plan their own writing, okay? And they need to think through these, if you give them some ideas like this, to think through before they start writing. So what greeting are they going to use in the opening line? Okay, right, having read the email from Alex, what's their reaction to that? Okay, in this case, Alex was unsure about whether he should join, go on TV with this band. So what should he do? What advice could you give him about that? And what should Alex say to his friends? And then obviously a way of signing off. So you're looking at the original email, and you know, you as the teacher can pick out just these little boxes here to ask your students to sort of give a response to them. But you need to train the students to do that themselves, because obviously in the exam, you're not going to be there with them, hopefully not anyway. And you need to they need to be thinking along these lines when they approach their own writing and when they're planning what they're going to do. Okay? So, writing a first draft, okay? It's good to encourage learners to write a first draft, as they're more likely to end up with a more effective piece of writing. The skills necessary for this stage are reading for detail, okay, as we said before, to make sure they know what they're doing. Organising their ideas, okay? So before they start writing the whole thing, they've put their ideas in little groups, okay? Using the appropriate structures for that genre. So they need to think that through. What are the kind of language, hopefully that's been practiced in class and outside class, and getting them thinking about that. And then they need to proofread as well. So they've written this and they need to look through and just think any obvious errors to go through them. Okay, so writing first draft, important part of that. And then checking drafts. Now here in the classroom, here's something you can do as a bit of pair work, so they can learn from each other. They can pick up ideas, they can pick up language from reading the work of others. And it helps them to focus on what is important in their own writing. Okay, so they can look through, when they look at their partner's email, have they organized it well? Have they written something for each planning category that we looked at before? Have they used a variety of vocabulary and grammar structures? It can be quite easy sometimes to stick with just one grammatical structure and quite basic vocabulary. Okay, just, you know, they need to think about that about their own work, but they sometimes think about it first by looking at others. Okay, and also the length of the text. Don't get them counting the number of words, but does it look about the right length? Okay, so say if they're checking each other's drafts, it gets them thinking along those lines and hopefully checking their own work when they come to the exam, or in real life skills when they're writing an email back to somebody, especially if it's an important one, making sure it's done what it's supposed to do. Okay.
There was a question asking if people would really have time in the exam to be able to write a draft. I mean, I would say yes, because if you do a lot of exam preparation with your students as they're coming up in the final weeks towards the exam, then they've got two writing questions to do in an hour and 30 minutes. If you say to them 10 minutes to read the questions at the beginning, 10 minutes at the end, you've got about 35, 40 minutes to spend on each question. And of that, spend at least 10 minutes doing a draft and doing a plan, because you do tend to find then that the organisation of the piece of writing and also the communication, that the ideas flow from one to another, that they answer each of the points that they've been given in the writing question, and they don't miss those things. You do tend to see that there is an improvement in that, rather than somebody jumping into the writing question, starting to write, and then getting right to the end of the exam on the second question and not having time to finish and to answer all of the points that they were asked to include. Had you anything to add there, Phil?
No, I think you covered that well, yeah.
Okay, thank you. All right, and we'll carry on. So, let's get back to our case study with Anya, because we looked at the start of the webinar at some of the many language and study skills that Anya needs in her everyday life at university and also for preparing for the world of work. And we've looked during the webinar at a few tasks from our B2 First for Schools and C1 Advanced exams, at the skills necessary for learners to complete them successfully, as well as how to develop these skills in the classroom. We've looked at how these skills are directly relevant to everything that Anya is required to do in her everyday life. So, Cambridge English exams are globally accepted by universities around the world for higher education. B2 First, C1 Advanced and C2 Proficiency are the Cambridge English exams commonly accepted for this purpose. And what you can see on screen now is just a selection of some of the universities that recognise our exams. There are actually many, many more. And again, if you look on our website and search for recognition, you can search by exam or you can search by country to see which institutions are accepting and recognising Cambridge English exams. Now, I'm sharing on screen with you a quote from the Deputy Head of Admissions at Bangor University in the UK, explaining why they like the C1 Advanced exam and what it means to them. Now, if we look, first of all, they're saying that they think it is great preparation for someone preparing to go to university, that they took the exam and they remember preparing for the exam actually to be quite enjoyable, learning language in a class, and that their exam and their certificate has been useful to them in allowing them to pursue the career that they have wanted to, and that they would recommend the C1 Advanced to any of their international students. It's absolutely great to have a quote like this from someone who's taken the exam themselves and who has used their Cambridge English certificate in this way to help pursue their career. Cambridge English exams are also widely accepted by employers around the world for recruitment, or they are used by them for training and development purposes within their organisations. On screen is just a selection of employers who recognise our exams. As with all Cambridge English exams, there is a wealth of support available for you as teachers to use in your classroom, as well as for learners and parents. Various free support materials are available to teachers and learners on the Cambridge English website. This is just a sample list of the types of support materials that are available. The Handbook for Teachers, for example, is available for each exam and explains exactly what's involved in each exam, in each paper, and in each task in the exams, how they should be approached, the skills required, and also suggestions for how these skills can be developed in the classroom. We'd just like to thank you, thank everybody for watching the webinar with Phil and myself today. We're now ready for any of your Q&A questions, and we're going to look at the Q&A chat box to see what questions you have from us. Just a reminder that you will be getting the slides from the webinar towards the end of the week. They'll be sent to you. Okay.
Couple of questions that come up. One about the going back to the writing, and we said about the number of words, and a question came up here which was, you know, if it says up to 180 or 190 words, is it a problem if they write 193? And as I said, don't when you're checking each other's work, don't ask your students to count how many words. That's a big waste of everybody's time. And the examiners don't do that either. Be assured of that. They are looking for approximately that length of question. So none of the examiners are counting how many words. And you don't lose marks. They don't refuse to mark it or anything like that if it's too long or too short. The idea of the number of words is that we think that's the area that is enough to answer the question. But you're not punished, as it were, if you write too few or too many. So don't get students worrying unduly about that.
Yeah, and it's quality, not quantity, isn't it? So in some ways, it's better to encourage students to write to around the word limit, as Phil was saying, and not to worry about trying to write more, because it's better that what they've written is as good as it can be in terms of grammar, vocabulary, communication, coherence, organisation, all those lovely things, rather than just writing and writing and writing if they're really fast writers. And if they practice in class, then they can have an idea of how much on the page for them is the word limit, so they don't have to count in the exam.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One person was asking something that needs to be considered is that in real life, we are sometimes caught out with questions and tasks. Unexpected, you know, we're preparing students, if you do this and if you do that and do this. Of course, you know, real life will throw all sorts of strange areas at us. But if you're prepared for the basics, then that gives you some kind of ability to respond even to the unusual situations that might arise and stuff. We can't, as teachers or as examiners, think of every feasible situation get people prepared for that, because there are just too many, etc. But I think, say, if you get the basics right, hopefully they can come up with ideas when they're thrown into a more unusual situation.
Yeah, and then they can use the skills that they've been taught as like coping strategies. I think I'm not sure if we've got time just for one more question. Maybe one short question. Okay. And then we're going to have to go.
There's a few people have been asking about how to improve writing skills in a large classroom. I think one thing there is to try and, if you can get the students to write to each other in a more fluency of writing approach, whether that's on paper or nowadays, if you allow them in the class, they might be able to write to each other on phones and things like that. Oops, sorry, dropped my glasses. And, we have writing for accuracy, and you as a teacher can take in their writing and mark it and things like that. But I think getting them to just write and write, that's going to improve them a lot, I think, if you just get used to writing rather than just doing it once every 1 or 2 weeks as part of your language class.
Yeah. Thank you. That's all from us today. Thank you for watching, and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.